Well, we're at a critical time in the history of our species on this planet, where there is more than ample evidence to suggest that if we don't figure out how to live well, then there's a good chance we will go extinct as a species and probably take a whole bunch of other species down with us.
Global warming is happening. Each of the past three decades has been warmer than the last, and warmer than any decade since we started keeping records.
I think global warming is one of the most serious challenges that humankind will have to face in this century.
The climate is changing, and it's not just the scientists that are saying so. People all over the world are noticing it. Heat waves and droughts in some parts, extreme rainfall and floods in others.
We are in the midst of the sixth great extinction, and the difference is that we humans are bringing it about.
Sea levels are rising. Arctic ice cover is shrinking. Crop yields are changing, getting smaller. Why is all this happening?
The Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, which is comprised of thousands of scientists nominated by their governments from all over the world, have concluded with more than 95% certainty that the recent warming of the climate is due to human activities. So that's less than a 1 in 20 chance that they're wrong.
Professor Guy Midgley is an acknowledged expert in the field of biodiversity and global change science. In 2007, he was a member of the international team who shared the Nobel Peace Prize for the fourth IPCC report and a coordinating lead author for the fifth assessment report released in 2015.
There's this huge body of evidence of a wide variety of types from the land, from the ocean, from the atmosphere, from the biophysical environment, and even from space, from satellites, that shows that this change is well underway.
A change in 2 degrees or even 4 degrees will be catastrophic, to put it mildly.
Ernst Conradie is a senior professor in the Department of Religion and Theology at the University of the Western Cape, where he teaches systematic theology and ethics. He has written numerous books and papers on environmental issues and religion, and is considered a world authority on Christianity and environmental justice.
If we don't do something this year, it will be too late. You will be in serious trouble if you live close to the end of the century. It is indeed that serious.
But what exactly is it that humans are doing that is contributing to this crisis?
The main thing we know that's causing the climate to change is these emissions of carbon dioxide from these fuels, which we call fossil fuels, because they were stored millions of years ago. But there is another important cause, and that is people cutting down forests and converting natural ecosystems into areas where we grow crops. And that also releases various kinds of gases, not only carbon dioxide, but other gases, which can cause the climate to change.
The billions of tons of released gases rise into the atmosphere, causing what's called a greenhouse effect, warming that results when the atmosphere traps heat radiating from Earth towards space.
If you put on a warm blanket on a hot day, you're going to get warmer. And carbon dioxide in the atmosphere adds, as it were, a blanket that warms us.
But not everyone agrees that climate change is caused by humans. A small group of scientists calling themselves the NIPCC, or Non-Governmental International Panel on Climate Change, claims that the current changes are merely a natural cycle.
There are, of course, people who claim that climate change is not what, in the technical term, anthropogenic. It's not generated by human beings. And in a way, you have to understand why they are saying that and where they are coming from. The Earth's climate has been changing all along throughout the geological history, and there have been many fluctuations and deviant patterns.
But Professor Midgley says that while natural climate cycles may explain why warming has happened unevenly over the past centuries, it does not explain the overall warming trend.
There is no natural cycle which can explain the recent warming of the Earth's atmosphere. There's been no warming of the sun or any other kind of natural event that would explain the warming that we've seen over the last 50 years.
On average, the planet is almost 1 degree centigrade warmer than it was in the late 19th century, and most of this warming has occurred in the last 50 years.
South Africa has warmed by much faster than the average global rate over the last 40 years. So parts of Africa, parts of South Africa have warmed by more than a degree for some months of the year.
According to the IPCC report, if we stick to our current path, it's likely that land temperatures over Africa will rise faster than the global land average, particularly in the more arid regions. We could see temperature increases of up to 6 degrees in some parts by the end of the century, and rising temperatures and CO2 levels have harmful effects on Earth's plant and animal life. But some scientists, those that produced the NIPCC report, say this is not a bad thing. They claim their studies prove that warming produces more benefits than harm for a wide range of plants and animals, and, not insignificantly, humans as well.
People who argue that rising CO2 through its effects on plants is a good thing just simply don't understand the potential negative effects. And ironically, where we would really want those effects to be strong, in temperate forests, for example, where the high latitude forests where increased growth would be advantageous, it doesn't happen because temperature is limiting the growth of those plants. So yes, CO2 does increase the growth of some plants, but for Africa especially, that's not the best thing in the world to happen.
Said that more than 80% of the world's 7 billion people belong to one or other religion or belief system. And all of them say that humans are the caretakers of the earth, that it is our duty to treat it with respect.
All of our scriptures and religions were written at a time when the relationship between humanity and the natural world was much closer. And in indigenous traditions and in the major religions of the world, nature was always held as something that we needed to respect, that it was something that was given to each generation to take care of and to pass to the next generation.
Nigel Crawhall is a director of the Indigenous Peoples of Africa Coordinating Committee, a network of 135 Indigenous Peoples organizations in 20 African countries. It's a membership organization concentrating on human rights, environmental governance, and climate justice issues. He's also a devout Buddhist and active member of the International Network of Engaged Buddhists. INEB has become the leading voice in articulating socially engaged Buddhism in the world.
So I think in all of our traditions, it's about understanding where we fit within the bigger picture, and that our ability to speak and think also puts obligations on us, that we have a custodian and stewardship role, which every one of our religions has articulated.
So we have to ask the question, if all the faiths say we are caretakers of the earth, why is it in such a mess? Have the religious leaders and their congregations failed in their God-given duties? What exactly do the various scriptures have to say about the environment?
In Genesis 1, we read that God looked on all that he had made, and behold, it was very good. And then he's given us the mandate. He says that we must look after it.
One of the most active campaigners for environmental justice in South Africa is Bishop Geoff Davies, together with his wife Kate. Lovingly known as the Green Bishop, he has long campaigned for churches to become more actively involved in caring for the earth.
The Hebrew does say he's given us rule or dominion over, and we have actually exploited that. We've misused and abused that.
Creation is a gift from God, and we are called not to subdue and exploit it, but we are called to use it for ourselves, but also to look after it.
The Most Reverend Dr. Thabo Makgoba is the Anglican Archbishop of Cape Town and Metropolitan of the Anglican Church of Southern Africa. He actively campaigns for environmental justice and encourages all members of the Anglican Church to live a responsible and respectful life in relation to nature.
There are passages like Psalm 24, verse 1, that the earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof. It reminds us that we are just visitors. We need to really treat the earth and creation, the environment, with dignity and care, afford it the sanctity it deserves.
In the Assisi Declarations on Nature, it says that in the ancient spiritual traditions, man was looked upon as part of nature, linked by spiritual and psychological bonds with the elements around him. This is very much true in Hinduism, probably the oldest living religious tradition in the world. The ancient Hindu scriptures, the Vedas, the Upanishads, and the Puranas, are permeated by a reverence for life. There is an awareness that the great forces of nature, the earth, the sky, the air, the water, and fire, as well as various orders of life, including plants and trees, forests and animals, and of course humans, are all bound to each other within the great rhythms of nature. We met with Sister Pratibha Daya of the Brahma Kumaris World Spiritual University in Cape Town. The movement, run mostly by women, encourages inner growth and a personal contribution towards making a better world.
The Brahma Kumaris, our core teaching is really the awareness of the self as consciousness, as a soul, and that the soul is energy, subtle energy. And so we look at the world around us as well as levels of energy, basically. And so with regards to the environment, we see the environment as well as an extension of this energy that is spiritual in nature. And so our teaching very much is really related to that. It's about respecting that form of energy as being also a sacred energy and not just matter alone.
And the scriptures of all the other faiths have similar messages. In the Jewish tradition, the Talmud says that heaven rewards the person who has concern and compassion for the rest of creation. Man was given dominion over nature, but he was commanded to behave towards the rest of creation with justice and compassion. The Islamic perspective is that we have to live in harmony with nature and the environment. The Muslim sacred scripture, the Quran, is filled with exhortations for believers to live in harmony with nature.
In the Holy Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala actually describes humans as the khalifas of the earth. And khalifas usually have this very strong meaning of being an official leader. But inherently, it actually means something a bit more. It means that we are stewards of the earth, we are caretakers of the earth, each and everyone in our own capacity.
And then there is a beautiful saying of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, in which he says, "Inna dunya khadiratun mustaghfilun," that the earth is green and beautiful. "Wa inna Allah mustakhlikum fiha," and God has made you stewards and custodians over it. "Fanadhirun kayfa ta'malun," but he is carefully observing and watching how you deal with the environment.
Nature is one of God's beautiful creations. Through nature, God is able to teach us, speak to us, and provide for us. For this reason, we can find in Scripture that we humans are called to protect all which He has created. In the Bible, Psalm 96 says, "Let the heavens rejoice, let the earth be glad, let the sea resound, and all that is in it. Let the fields be jubilant, and everything in them. Then all the trees of the forest will sing for joy."
The Bible is filled to the brim with ecology and or ecological wisdom. And that is simply true. It's not just about creation and about over-references to the natural world. But once you start looking for references to trees and waters and rivers and land, you find absolutely every page of the Bible. It's not as if it is something that is foreign or strange.
There are two books of God. There's the natural world, and there's the Bible. And that we can learn so much about God through the natural world.
By studying creation, by studying the environment, we're learning about God.
Colin Jackson is Deputy Director for Conservation and Science at the Kenya National Museum and is involved in bird conservation at a national level. He started Arusha Kenya in 1999. Arusha is a Christian organization which focuses on environmental education, conservation science, and community conservation.
Johann Kepler in the 1700s, who was a Christian and a very switched on scientist. He described science as thinking God's thoughts after him, which I love. I think that's a great thing, because you know, God thought it all up and he designed it and he put it all there years ago, you know. And here we are trying to work out how it works. And as we discover it, we're actually thinking God's thoughts after him.
One of the core teachings of the Baha'i faith is that nature reflects the qualities and attributes of God and should, therefore, be greatly respected and cherished. Tahirah Matthee is the director of the Baha'i Office of Public Affairs in South Africa.
The Baha'i teachings place a lot of emphasis on wholesome living, on beauty, on giving the respect due to all life forms. In actual fact, there are many, many writings which exhort us to be kind to animals and to be able to experience the beauty of the soul and the spirit in all of this other beauty that has been provided for us.
For many Africans, there is no clear-cut separation between what is secular and what is sacred. Everything and every act is looked upon in a religious perspective. So the consequences of climate change in Africa, like the decrease in yields, annihilation of some species of plants and animals, droughts, famine, floods, and health issues, have received religious interpretations. Because in African traditional religious belief, misfortune and disasters do not occur without a cause which can only be spiritually explained.
We ran a workshop in Gabon, in Central Africa, on the role of forests and climate change. And we had a number of different indigenous groups at the workshop. And there were these elders who came down from the jungle area up in the northeast. And we explained to them about the carbon cycle and around pollution, around climate change. And they were completely dumbfounded. And they looked at us and they said, "You are telling us that people in cities cause this problem from their emissions, from making pollution? We thought we did something wrong." So here is a group of people in a remote rural jungle where a big river runs through this area, where there's a lot of wildlife, a very, very beautiful area. But they could see that the entire forest was changing. The seasons were changing, the plants were changing, the animals were changing. But they took responsibility. They thought spiritually they had offended the forest somehow. And I thought within that is a story that is very powerful, that indigenous people take complete responsibility for their relationship to the earth, but people who live in urban areas cause this cataclysmic mess on the planet, but don't take any responsibility at all.
So we know that the Earth and all its inhabitants face what is probably the greatest crisis in living memory, and we accept that it is largely caused by human activities. But what is really at the core of this apparent insanity that is driving us to destroy ourselves?
Well, what is the real heart of the problem? What is the core problem that we're looking at here? And really it comes down to greed. It comes down to self-centeredness. It comes down to people wanting something more for themselves, over and above a concern for the environment there.
God's plan is that we should have as much as we need. He provides for our needs, but not our greed. And our present-day world is encouraging greed.
According to the World Watch Institute, human civilization will collapse and efforts to tackle global warming will fail unless the world stops its culture of greed and excessive consumerism. Consumption has grown dramatically over the past 5 decades and expenditures per person almost tripled.
The commodification of nature and the rise of consumerism goes hand in hand because now nature is to be consumed.
Nirmala Nair is a consultant at the National Adaptation Programme of Action at the Tarayana Foundation in Bhutan. She believes that sustaining life is all about learning to live the dynamic balance of our unique inner and outer ecosystems. She started the School of Practical Sustainability to combine her mindfulness work with exploring simple practical solutions that embody local wisdom in the face of the ever-changing climate chaos.
The sanctity of nature is gone, deeper intelligence of nature is gone, but we have shaped nature for our benefit to consume.
The world, the earth, is finite, so we cannot have constant growth because eventually the earth will run out of the resources that we have been using.
Buddhist Tsondru Sonam is a board member of the South African Faith Communities Environmental Institute. She says the Buddha taught that we need to develop a sense of universal responsibility to collectively and individually protect and nurture the environment in which we all live. She believes we have forgotten these wise words.
So we constantly take things from the earth, which is not getting any bigger. We make things with it. We sell it to each other. And then we throw things away into the earth again.
In the past 60 years, metals production grew by 600%, oil consumption by 800%, and natural gas consumption 1400%. More than 60 billion tons of resources are now extracted annually, which is about 50% more than just 40 years ago.
Nature is now no more nature, it's natural resources. And if you start looking at the whole concepts that are floating around, you can begin to understand the deep shift away from nature as something sacred, nature's intelligence as something that is a guiding principle of life force as such, to natural resource management.
The Ecological Footprint Indicator, which compares humanity's ecological impact with the amount of productive land and sea area available to supply key ecosystems, shows that humanity now uses the resources and services of 1.3 Earths. In other words, people are using about a third more of Earth's capacity than is available, undermining the resilience of the very ecosystems on which humanity depends.
We've got to figure out how to live here, on this home, our planet, but it's not ours alone. And we've got to figure out how to live well together with others.
Rob is talking about the bar.
Dr. Dayna Baumeister is a biologist with a devotion to applied natural history and a passion for sharing the wonders of nature with others. She works in the field of biomimicry, a relatively new science which looks at sustainable solutions to human challenges by emulating nature's patterns and strategies.
There are very strong limits to the amount of fresh water that's available to us, how much capacity our atmosphere has to hold carbon dioxide. And while we've sort of intuited this most of our time on the planet, science today has demonstrated over and over again that we live on a finite planet. And if we don't learn how to live well with those resources that are limited here, then we have a good chance of going extinct.
Let's think about that for a moment. If we don't make serious and immediate changes, we could go extinct. And most of the insect and animal species we know and love will disappear too. Imagine a world with no humans, no animals, no birds. A barren landscape in an ever-warming wilderness. But like it has done many times before, the Earth will recover, perhaps grateful that its greatest enemy, humans, are gone.
We have to stop measuring happiness in terms of growth. And we have to become aware of our greed and try and be less needy and aspire to be content with less and to think of others before we think of ourselves.
Why do we do it? There is strong evidence that higher levels of consumption do not significantly increase the quality of life beyond a certain point, and they may even reduce it. Psychological evidence suggests that it is close relationships, a meaningful life, economic security, and health that contribute most to well-being.
We are encouraged through the media to seek greater wealth, to aspire after it. And that's not what we should be about. We should be about saying, well, what are things that are really going to bring greater happiness, which are going to benefit you and your family, and to recognize that actually living in peaceful, non-violent, trusting communities, being able to go out and enjoy a lovely meadow with flowers and a flowing stream, to enjoy the beauty of the natural environment, is actually much more important than owning a really expensive car.
We have established that the scriptures of all the faiths talk about us being caretakers of the earth and tell us to treat it with respect. And we know that in the last 100 years or so, we have largely ignored those instructions. While knowledge of the scriptures is important and should be studied, just knowing about them is not enough. Without some form of action, the situation will only get worse. So the question is, do religions have an important role to play in helping the earth heal itself?
You know, I think religions have an increasingly important role, and it's actually vital and essential that they recognize that they have a very, very important role, apart from the fact that God told us to look after his amazing creation.
We get involved because we care for the environment, and faith groupings ought to get involved because it is the right thing to do at the right time for the right reasons.
It's not as if you can talk about, let's say, Protestant rivers and Muslim forests and Catholic lakes and Jewish whatever else. We live on one planet and we need to collaborate with one another in order to deal with the challenges that lie ahead.
Faith communities can create impact by being examples. You know, when we bring in more simplicity in our own lives, it's through our example of simplicity that we inspire that within our communities.
So we need to be humble, and we need to work together with people of other faiths, people of no faith, in conserving the common environment, because this is a common challenge facing all of us.
And it seems to be working. In the last 5 years, there has been an explosion of interest and concern about the environment worldwide.
And now we're seeing a global mobilization of Christians, Jews, Muslims, Buddhists, Hindus, Jains, Sikhs, whoever you name it. People are waking up and realizing that we have to apply our spiritual resources to the challenges that we're facing right now. And I'm happy to be a little piece of that.
In 2005, Bishop Geoff Davies established SAFC, the South African Faith Communities Environmental Institute. Its aim is to communicate the challenges of climate change and the environmental crisis in general to faith communities, as well as civil society and government. Although retired now, he and Kate remain active in the support of SAFC initiatives, one of which is the weekly anti-nuclear vigil outside Parliament in Cape Town.
People from different religious communities come together on a Wednesday, every Wednesday morning, to stand outside Parliament to protest against this nuclear deal that South African government seems committed on. We really believe that this is the wrong direction for our energy path. Renewable energy can be built quickly, safely, and it's much cheaper.
SAFC questions why South Africa is considering building nuclear power stations when many countries in Europe are shutting theirs down due to safety concerns. And at a cost of 1 trillion rand, the country will be deeply in debt for decades, and sooner or later, consumers will pay the price.
The constitution of our country allows us as citizens to have a voice. So advocacy is about taking that voice of the public, of the common people, and bringing it to the notice of decision makers. So by bringing that voice to decision makers, we actually are influencing how they make decisions on our behalf. And we have a right to do that. And from a faith perspective, what we believe is the morals and values that underpin all the different faiths are something that decision makers need to heed when they make decisions.
Liz McDade, together with SAFC, regularly run workshops in a number of regions in South Africa and in other African countries.
SAFC is an organization that works throughout the SADC region. And what we're finding is that churches and mosques and temples and the people of faith are interested in actually learning more about the environment.
So you're concentrating the heat. And that's the concept.
Participants representing various faiths and denominations throughout the continent attend the workshops where they are taught the basics of climate change, environmental consciousness, and are given practical methods that they can take back to their own congregations.
This training provides an opportunity for me to learn skills that I can take back to my country and train my colleagues about advocacy and what they can do in their own communities.
We are stewards of God's creation. So as a church, we've got to preach that gospel to the people so that we keep God's environment well.
I believe there's a world out there that people do not know about. There are dimensions out there that if you had to understand, changes your whole perspective to life as holistically.
We have to be stewards of the environment, and the environment is us.
If we take action now, we can make a great change.
I believe that I've got a duty, and as part of evangelization, as my faith is, to be part of the process of bringing change and a paradigm shift.
When I go back home, I like to go to my church and start tree planting. Like, for example, on Christmas, we plant a tree. On Easter, we plant a tree. Then, until it's a habit, then you try every day to plant a tree. Because tree is life. Life is tree.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, ya tulab.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Today we're going to do a very, very interesting topic.
Muslims for Eco Justice is a project of the Claremont Main Road Mosque, a faith community committed to working towards a more sustainable world. They say that environmental justice is intrinsic to being a conscientious Muslim.
Cooking.
Looking at where the world is at the moment environmentally,
There actually has to be some action towards becoming a greener world. So we thought that having such a project as Muslims Eco Justice would target the faith community, the Muslim faith community specifically, to just get everyone aware of the fact that we can actually do something as individuals to tackle climate change.
When we make, we do. This is the way I wash my mouth. Wash my mouth, wash my mouth. This is the way I wash my mouth. When I make wudu.
Muslims are required to be clean and wear good clothes before they present themselves before God. So they do the wudu, the ritual washing performed by Muslims before prayer.
So part of the work that Muslims for Eco Justice does is work in partnership with madrasas for them to actually teach children how to perform wudu in an eco-friendly way, apart from also teaching them other means of caring for the environment.
Lynne, nose.
The green ablution is basically to be conservative, very conservative in saving water, you know. Now, if you go around to the masjids or the mosques, as we would say, sometimes you'll find people, they're taking ablution that we will call the wudu, and the amount of water that people take to make an ablution would be enough for you or me to take a shower, you know, wastage. So what we're going to be teaching is how to take that ablution with the minimal wastage.
At the Dar es Salaam Masjid in Mitchell's Plain, they have a different approach to water saving.
We realized for the area we're staying in, it's underprivileged, very poor basically, and we were looking at this amount of water that just go to waste. We decided we've got a soup kitchen, let's make use of this water, and that's why we lead all our pipes is lead into a tank, and that tank has been feeding our vegetable garden.
The masjid looks after 120 children in the creche, and this number swells to 360 in the afternoons.
Now we needed to create something where the children can realize at the early stage that they can become self-sufficient with a little bit of space.
We do cooking here, and we thought it's good for the children to know that what they're eating actually comes from the ground. And it's God's creation.
We're saving the water, we're feeding our plants with the water. The children in the same time realize, but my soup I'm getting, I grew something for my soup.
The children are taught how to plant the seeds, to water the garden every day, and to nurture the plants until they have grown big enough to harvest.
It's unbelievable how excited they become, because this is their own little project, you know, and they are actually responsible for it.
That if we don't make significant changes in the near future, we may not survive. So what is being done to make these changes happen? Perhaps most significant is the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, which was established in 1992 and now has 197 member countries. The parties to the convention have met annually from 1995 in conferences of the parties, or COP, to assess progress in dealing with climate change. The 21st session of the Conference of the Parties, called COP21, took place from the 30th of November to the 11th of December 2015 in Paris, France. Here, an historic agreement to combat climate change was signed by 195 nations. The Paris Agreement, for the first time, brings all nations into a common cause based on their historic, current, and future responsibilities.
If you look at the documentation and the information that's built up over these 20 years, it's an extraordinary amount of knowledge. There's never been an international effort like the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. It is the first real effort by the world to regulate its own fate.
2 months before COP21, a large crowd of concerned citizens gathered at Milnerton Beach in Cape Town for an event called Light the Way. Representatives of all the major and minor religions were there to show their support. Organized by Action 2015, together with several other local organizations, it was part of a worldwide event called Global Day of Action. Thousands around the globe called on world leaders to light the way for a better future for people and the planet. The event was timed to take place on the evening before the United Nations Historical Sustainable Development Summit in New York, where world leaders adopted new development goals which will have the potential to tackle poverty, inequality, and climate change. It was here that Pope Francis made an historic speech on the rights of the environment. He said that an attack on the environment was an assault on the rights and living conditions of the most vulnerable, warning that at its most extreme, environmental degradation threatened humanity's survival. Any harm done to the environment, therefore, is harm done to humanity, Pope Francis said. The ecological crisis and the large-scale destruction of biodiversity can threaten the very existence of the human species.
So what you're seeing tonight is a global rally of civilians, of people all over the world that are tired of poverty, of inequality, and of the damage that we're doing to ourselves and causing this climate change with major destructive consequences.
Desert Rose is based in Cape Town and is widely regarded as leading composers, producers, and performers of universal world music.
We've chosen to put all our energy into using music in the area of climate justice and climate action because we really do feel that this sums up the full manifestation of the human condition, which is one of greed and one of being disconnected.
To show their support for the United Nations Sustainable Development Summit, COP21, and the Fast for the Climate Global Movement, they wrote this song.
This year for France, in support of the Fast for Climate action, we've chosen a song called Just One Day, almost describing the one day each month where we abstain. It speaks of just for a moment where we can stop. We're on this rat race, just crazy, moving forward at such a rate, just for one day, just stop and take note. The earth is speaking, I give you night, I bring you day. I support your life in every way. Now all I ask for is just one day. And the French translates, into just one day of no feasting, no killing, just one day of no mining, no burning, no destroying, just one day of no exploitation. And then the chorus goes into a chant. We're just using sounds, almost like Hopi Indian sounds that don't have a particular language, but have the emotion of the frustration of the elements of nature and of the indigenous people who never lost their connection with that.
When astronaut Neil Armstrong made history as the first man to walk on the moon in July 1969, he looked up and saw the Earth, bright blue in the black sky. Later, he said, "It suddenly struck me that that tiny pea, pretty and blue, was the Earth. I put up my thumb and shut one eye, and my thumb blotted out the planet Earth. I didn't feel like a giant. I felt very, very small."
It's really hard to get a concept about how finite and the fact that we live on just a small rock floating through the galaxy. And it wasn't until the late 60s when we actually went up into space and turned around and looked back at our blue dot, the sole planet that we know that supports us and life as we know it. And the key to remember that this is it. This is our home. There is no plan B. Mars and Alpha Centauri are not options for us.
Pale Blue Dot is a photograph of planet Earth taken on February 14, 1990 by the Voyager 1 space probe from a record distance of about 6 billion kilometers. In his book, Pale Blue Dot, A Vision of the Human Future in Space, which was inspired by this picture, astronomer and cosmologist Carl Sagan wrote, "Look again at that dot. That's here. That's home. That's us. On it, everyone you love, everyone you know, everyone you ever heard of, every human being who ever was, lived out their lives. Our planet is a lonely speck in the great enveloping cosmic dark. In our obscurity, in all this vastness, there is no hint that help will come from elsewhere to save us from ourselves." In part two, we meet a group of amazing individuals who are using the relatively new science of biomimicry to study the way nature does things. We will see how they are using the lessons they learn to design environmentally friendly products and processes that will revolutionize the way humans live on planet Earth in the years ahead.